Good evening and welcome to worship here on the longest night at Bethlehem United Methodist Church. It's a joy to greet you, to have you all here tonight. Thank you for taking time to come. Tonight is a space for us to be real, to acknowledge those places during this otherwise upbeat and joyous season where we may not be feeling upbeat and joyous. It's a time to acknowledge our grief and our loss, and to be okay with that. And I believe that you will find that God meets us in that space. So as we begin our time together, I'm going to invite you to stand for our choral call to worship. Come, thou long expected Jesus. Following that, we will have the call to worship. Let us stand.
To our call to worship, followed by the opening prayer. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made by God, and without God, nothing came into being. What came to be through God was life, and this life was the light of the world. And you respond. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Let us pray. O God, come to our assistance. We have gathered here this evening because we long for you to come to us, to save us, to comfort us, to bring us peace. As we approach the day when we celebrate the birth of Jesus, we grow in our awareness that we need you. We bring our grief, our pains, our disappointments, our fears, and the chaos of this world, and we lay all of that before you in this time of worship. As Jesus embodied your love for the world and became God with us, so now this night we pray that you would again come, O come, Emmanuel. Amen. Please be seated.
Going to lead us in a litany of remembrance and Advent candle lighting. I'll be reading as I light the candles, and then you will be invited to respond afterward. We light this first candle to remember those whom we've loved and lost. We pause to remember clearly their faces, their voices, their bodies. We embrace and give thanks for the memories that bind them to us in this season of expectation, when all creation waits for the light and hope that it brings. May God's eternal love surround them. We light this second candle to remember the pain of loss, loss of relationships, loss of trust, loss of jobs, loss of health, loss of faith, the loss of joy. We acknowledge and embrace the pain of the past, O God, and we offer it to you, asking that into our wounded hearts and open hands you will place the gift of peace. We remember that through you all things are possible. Refresh, restore, renew us, O God, and lead us into your future. We light this third candle to remember ourselves this Christmas time. We pause and remember the past weeks, months, and for some of us, years that have been heavy with our burdens. We accept and lay before you, God, the sadness and grief, the hurt and fear, the anger and pain, and the time we have walked alone in darkness, in deep need of your love and presence. We remember that though we have journeyed far, and that while lost, we may have turned away from the light itself has not failed. We remember that though winter be upon us, and though the night be dark, with time the dawn will come, and dawn defeats the darkness. We light this fourth candle to remember faith, the gift of light and hope that God offers to us in the stories of Hanukkah and of Christmas, which both also began in abandonment, insecurity, and humbleness, in a time of war and in a poor stable. We remember that the loving God who kept the light shining in the temple and who came to share this life with us promises us comfort and peace. We remember the one who shares our burdens, who shows up the way to the light, and who journeys with us into all our tomorrows. Our opening hymn is going to be Star Child. I invite you to enjoy this and listen carefully to the words. You may remain seated.
Star child, earth child, go between of God, love child, Christ child, heaven's lightning rod. This year, let the day arrive, when Christmas comes for everyone, everyone alive. Child, be child, no place left to go. Her child, youth child, no one wants to know. This year, let the day arrive, when Christmas comes for everyone. comes for everyone, everyone alive.
We come to this time in our service where we call an opportunity of invitation to candle lighting. And what we do here is we honor and recognize those who we may have lost this year, those who are part of our journey through this difficult season, this season of adding, of Advent, of waiting and expectation. And as you come to light a candle, I invite you to take a stick here and light it from the Christ candle in the center, and then light one of the votives. If you'd like to share about your loved one, I invite you to do that here. We'll have the mic on. You don't need to be afraid of it. If you need to touch the mic, I have hand sanitizer here afterward. If you feel like you need to do that, that's fine too. So I invite you to come as you feel led to share. And we welcome your stories. Feel free to be real and honest, and you will be received with love and grace.
I remember my brother, Charles William Haddock. We called him Chase. He died this year. He had a stroke, a couple of them, several. And what's especially hard is that we were estranged. And so we didn't know when he passed away. It was just before Easter. And we found out because I was Googling him on the internet, and up popped his obituary. You know, you can imagine how horrible that was. And he was my only living brother. So now I'm an only child, which is really weird because I grew up with two brothers. So, you know, the only thing that is worse than losing your brother and both of my brothers and my dad is that my mom has lost her sons and her husband.
I light this candle for my mother, Eloise Phillips, who died 11 days after her 96th birthday this summer.
I light this candle for my sweet Uncle Charlie, who was so much like my daddy, his older brother, who died and was a great war eagle for the Auburn Tigers. Mm-hmm.
I light this candle for the hundreds of thousands of people that have lost loved ones in the last 9 months, their families. And I've lost a couple people I know, but they weren't my immediate family, but I feel such a bond of grieving and sorrow with all these people. So in remembrance and honor of these folks, I light that candle.
I lost my father 4 years ago last week, and it was 4 years ago, but it brings, you know, this time of year is really tough, and it brings back memories that you value, and also times that have been lost, and it's one of those things that you just never get over. And in addition to that, I've become somewhat estranged with my mother and I both with my sons, and that's been particularly hard on my mother, which those of you know, it's like you can do anything to me, but not to my mother. So it's been hard for me and hard watching her through that process. Pastor David knows that I usually read and reread The Purpose-Driven Life every starting January 1st, and this year I chose to do it during the last 40 days of the year. And timely enough, as today would have it, it focused on Romans 8:28, which really tells us that the good times and the bad times are meant to shape us and to prepare us for eternity, and we have to keep the faith and focus on that, and so that's what I've been trying to do. Thanks.
And light this candle for parents. Parents and father-in-law, all people who had a big influence on my life, on my family. And so I offer a prayer for John Hammond's Velda Coffee and Rake.
I light one candle for my brother, Michael Brown, a career firefighter who died the same day Jack's mom did. And the second for my beautiful daughter, Whitney Lynn DeBoard, who died June 20th, at the age of 35. I light my candle in honor of my father, Charles McKenzie. And if it weren't for my dad and my mom, I wouldn't know the Lord the way I do. I was so blessed to grow up with two loving parents in a wonderful, loving family with loving siblings. And the love and joy that I have gleaned from my father and the love that he has shown me will carry me the rest of my life. And I pray that I honor him by sharing that love with others. And I'm just so thankful for him in my life.
I light that candle for several people. Macklin Woodford, my sister-in-law, her son-in-law, Jim Hallahan, for our dear church friend, Patricia Williamson, and for my college friend, Veda Boyd, and cousin, Carl Lavender.
I light a candle for Kevin Coffey. He was my nephew. He was 19 years old when he died. He was an Eagle Scout. He was an amazing, amazing young man. He meant so much to all of us, and especially Mary, my sister-in-law, and his parents, Ray and Maxine. Have a blood drive in his honor every year, at the university where he attended in Philadelphia Temple. And he's just an amazing young man I'd like to remember. He had an incredible life for such a short life. And we all miss Kevin.
I meant to say this when I was up here last time, and it's the Eagle Scout in me, but there are so many things this year that have been pulling at us, things that affect us really near and dear to our hearts and things around us. And I want to pray for our country. We are one nation under God. And I saw a bumper sticker this week that said, "Make America Kind Again." I don't think I've ever seen so much division, not even in the 60s, as we have today. And I really pray that we can come together as a nation and be kind to one another again.
I light one candle for Judy's dad, and one candle for Larry Brubaugh, good friend.
I like this friend candle for Larry Brumall, a very dear friend who was an inspiration to all of us. Now he resides with our Lord.
If anybody else would like to come forward, I don't want to stop this part of our service until we're ready. I light a candle for my mom and dad. I don't think I could have been more eloquent than my sister. And just so you know, I don't normally wear neckties. This is for my dad. It's not the Mackenzie plaid. I know, Jack, you probably acknowledge that, but the boys got the Mackenzies. But it's one of his Scotch plaid ties. And I have to admit, Dad died on December 4th from coronavirus. I know, Judy, your father passed away from coronavirus also, and I just want to lay it here. I struggle with anger, frustration with people who don't seem to want to love their neighbor as they love themselves. But in saying that, I realize I'm one of those who's struggling to love my neighbor by judging them. So I'm grateful for a space where we can remember those who we love and acknowledge our grief and bring it to God. We're going to hear a song before we go into our meditation, and this song to me is very important. It's called Breath of Heaven, is the song of Mary, and I'm going to talk a little bit about it after we hear Rose sing. So I invite you to listen to the words and perhaps put yourself in this place of challenge and angst, and let us hear God's real word through song.
As you watch my face, if a wiser one should have had my place, but I offer all I am for the mercy of your plan. Help me be strong. Help me be me together be forever near me, breath of heaven, breath of heaven, light in my darkness, pour over me your holiness, for you are holy.
Do you remember when you fell in love with God? Do you remember that moment? Some people have a date, the date that they embraced their faith in Jesus Christ. Some people, like me, grew up just knowing God, being raised in a church, and that's all I knew was this faith. I kind of grew into it. There wasn't a bolt of lightning or anything like that. But some people have had big experiences of turning to God, of changes. I know later in my 40s, I had an experience that awakened me to a new relationship with God, and my head knowledge that I do not discount. I had a close relationship with God, but it was a head knowledge of God, and then some things happened and it sunk into my heart, and I started feeling these things that I knew about, feeling God's love in a new way, God's grace and mercy. And you know, when you're in those spaces, if you've had a mountaintop experience, you can imagine what Mary felt like as we heard this Sunday in the lectionary, the Magnificat, as Mary exclaims with joy her love of God and her welcoming with open arms what is happening to her. From the Message translation of Scripture, you hear Mary, "I am bursting with God news. I'm dancing the song of my Savior God. God took one look at me and look what happened. I'm the most fortunate woman on earth. What God has done for me will never be forgotten. The God whose very name is holy, set apart from all others. His mercy flows in wave after wave on those who are in awe before him." So we may have had those mountaintop moments too. But we don't stay there, do we? I can't imagine an unwed teenager, pregnant, poor, having to travel quite a long distance and staying on that mountaintop. I think the song we heard, Breath of Heaven, is probably a large part of Mary's experience those many months. "I have traveled many moonless nights, cold and weary, with a babe inside. And I wonder what I've done, Holy Father, that you have come and chosen me to carry your son." Do you all feel this? I am waiting in silent prayer. I'm frightened by the load I bear. In a world as cold as stone, must I walk this path alone? Be with me now. Be with me now. And then she sings to God, "Breath of Heaven." Think of God's breath, Ruach, this wind, the Holy Spirit. She's praying to God, breath of heaven, hold me together. Be forever near me. Lighten my darkness. Pour over me your holiness, for you are holy. Breath of heaven. So I ask you, which expression of Mary's faith is better? This strong in her faith, this confident, this outward praising, or this frightened, doubtful, fearful expression of faith? Well, I'm going to answer that with a parable. I heard a story one time in Luke chapter 15, the story of the lost sheep. And before I begin this story, I want to tell you, back in 2009, I had a pretty serious health crisis that just took me to my knees. I was scared to death, or at least part of me that I would admit was scared to death. The rest of me was full of, it's going to be okay, I'm fine, don't worry, all is well. And I remember after many sleepless nights writing in my journal, I'm okay, 99% of me is okay. But I have to admit, there's 1% of me that is scared to death. Well, that Sunday in worship, wouldn't you know, we heard this parable. And it just hit me like I'd never heard it before. You know, we imagine the lost sheep, the shepherd who has 100 sheep and one is lost, and he goes to find that one, putting all his effort into one, leaving the 99 on the side while he went searching. And I realized that's what God does to us. We think we are part of the 99, and there's somebody outside the building that needs to be here, but no, sometimes there is within us this false sense of comfort and I'm good to go, and there's part of us that we don't want to admit that is lost, that is broken, that is hurting, that doesn't want to tell anybody, that is afraid to be honest, afraid to be real and vulnerable. And you know, where is God? God is all about that broken part of us. God may be saying, hey, I'm glad you're good, but I'm worried about that part of you that's not. That's where God meets us. God is all about the lost, the broken, those who are hurting. God didn't need to come to a world that was all right, that was good to go. God came to a world that was broken. And God did so in a way that God showed God's own vulnerability and powerlessness, coming into this baby born out in the middle of nowhere to this young girl. It's quite the story. And while Mary is there in this stable or cave, as we may understand it, because that warm, comfy place where she would have been okay maybe wasn't available, she's out there, and who comes but a community comes to surround her, to sing, to bring gifts, to encourage her, to be a light to her in the middle of this stable where there are animals about. And so we find God in these corners of places where there are broken people and communities that come and surround us with love. We hear in the Beatitudes, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. We don't often think of us who are grieving that we would be blessed, but we are, as God's community surrounds us and pours out God's love to us. We experience God in a very unique and different way. The Message version of that scripture says, you're blessed when you've lost what is most dear to you. Only then will you be embraced by the one most dear to you. This is Emmanuel, the God who is with us. In this season, in the midst of our brokenness, we have to think of joy as not something that comes from the ups and downs and circumstances of our everyday lives, but joy is based in the knowledge that even in the midst of our darkness, God has overtaken the world. God brings this light into the darkness. I was visiting with Cheryl a couple of weeks ago outside. We had to distance, and so we were outside on her front sidewalk, and we're kind of sitting behind the trees where people from the road wouldn't necessarily see us, although Karen found us out there. But we were sitting, and I had my feet up on this planter in front of the parsonage, and there's this beautiful dogwood that's growing up in front of the house. And it's been planted there some 30 years, and over time you can see where some branches were going to grow into the house, and they got cut off. And there's this one trunk that's just chopped, and over time there's this scar, a tree scar. It's kind of grown over that wound, and then right close to the end there's a shoot that sticks straight up, and it's just, it's new and it's fresh. And I think as we are like Mary, broken and struggling, we still carry this Christ child in us, something that is ready to be born, something that will be new, something that will be different, something that will change us, something that will change the world. So this season, I am anxiously waiting for that center candle, waiting for Christmas to come anew, that even in this season of grief and change, that God will bring forth new life. It may be different for all of us what that new life looks like. But as we step into it, I encourage you to breathe. Breath of heaven, hold me together. Help me be strong. Help me be. Help me, Mary sings. I do not feel that being real, being vulnerable, and being honest is anything to discount. Our culture wants to say that no, we must be brave, we must be strong, we must always have these spiritual platitudes that all is well, that God's in charge, that there's a plan. But we are part of a broken world, and it's okay to say that. Because when we can claim that, when we can be real with our feelings, that's where we truly experience God's love and God's mercy. We're going to hear another song before we go to communion. And I think this song wraps up this birthing and what it is that is being birthed. Going to hear a song called Welcome to Our World, and then together we're going to experience God in a fresh way. We've taken communion before, and I want to remind you that communion is not just a sign. It doesn't just point to something, but communion has a deeper meaning. As David blesses the elements, we believe that these elements are changed in a way that we can't quite articulate. However, we believe that these elements actually become symbols of God's love and grace for us. Just like getting a Christmas card, someone might say, "I'm Merry Christmas, and I'm thinking of you, and I love you, and God's love given to you this holy season." But seeing someone, embracing them, being embraced by God, is a tangible experience of God's love and grace. This is how we drink in God. So friends, I invite you to listen to this song that will introduce us to this time of community and of receiving God again anew, that we might be changed.
Are breaking, how we need to hear from God. You've been promised, we've been waiting. Welcome, Holy Child. Welcome, Holy Child. Hope that you don't mind our manger, how I wish we would have known. But long awaited,
please make yourself at home. Bring your peace into our violence. Bid our hungry souls be filled. Word now breaking heaven's silence. Welcome to our world. Welcome to our world. Fragile fingers sent to heal us. Tender brow prepared for thorn. Tiny heart whose blood will save us, unto us is born. Unto us is born. So wrap our injured flesh around you. Breathe our air and walk our sod. Rob our sin and make us holy, perfect Son of God. Perfect Son of God. Welcome to our world.
As we come to this time of Holy Communion, it's a great thanksgiving that is specific for tonight. Your responses will be on the screen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. From the silence before creation, your word spoke all that is into being. You saw the darkness and called forth light, dividing the day from the night, and giving each its name and your blessing. We abused your blessing, choosing to control rather than tend, to consume rather than nourish, to turn away from your light and turn your darkness into a hiding place, a place of fear and shame. Still, you chose to bless us and redeem us, calling us to restored fellowship through prophets, leaders, and faithful people. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. From the darkness of a stable, you brought forth the light of the world. He carried your light into every darkened corner, calling those kept in darkness to rejoice in your love, and exposing those who hid from your truth to the light of your righteous judgment. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, drink this. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ in his suffering, one with each other in mutual love, and one in ministry to all the world with healing grace, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at your heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ taught us to pray, we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we conclude our service with Holy Communion, to receive, we're going to take these trays that has the little cups. They'll be on the table, so on your way outside, take a cup with you, and we'll gather there under the portico distance, and then we'll receive the cup and the little wafer together. You peel off the top, there's the little wafer, you peel it off again, and then there's the juice. So we're going to close with, I want to walk as a child of the light. And as we exit, please take one of these if you want to put on your jacket, your coat. We'll go outside and conclude there. So I'll offer our, is our song now, Susan? Mm-hmm. We'll have it now.
You can do the benediction.
And then we'll go outside.